day, or it is 200 radio stations which are working in this country, or 800 channels which have been sanctioned by Ministry of Information Broadcasting, whether it's 1200 feature films I'm talking about, whether it is 22 crore mobiles, which has also now become part of media and entertainment, and an unlimited, maybe 1 billion internet PCs connected in this country, which are available today, they are looking for change, because at the end of the day, media can only run if they have money coming back to them. तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि इतना रहे ख्याल सताने के साथ साथ कि हम भी बदल रहे हैं जमाने के साथ साथ.
So you raised a very interesting point about revenue. So you know, we just the earlier session was also about this cap on the duration of ads that can be shown on television. Is that going to affect content, both in terms of whether it's supported enough by business, but creatively, is it a better thing? You know. So, Sanjeev, would you like to say something?
Priyanka, I haven't the faintest clue about it. There are big networks, and you know, it's their job to understand how that is going to pan out. I think, from the point of view of a content creator, I heard in the you know, about so much change, but I think content has only changed as much as we have. We always tend to look at the consumer of content as somebody else. How about just looking in the mirror, look at yourself, look at who you are, look at the disposable time that you have to yourself, look at what you're looking for, look at the answers that are relevant to you, that are important to you, how you find them. I think that, you know, content creators need to stand in the mirror, look at them, look at themselves, rather than go across the country researching people and look at them as somebody else. And I think that's really what's going to be important for content of the future. We did some understanding of people across the country, and whereas television for many reasons has got dubbed idiot box, I think at some level the internet is going to be dubbed as brain box, because a lot of people are looking for knowledge. A lot of people are looking to take the next step in life, and they're looking at richly packaged videos to help them take their next step. We're all, the obligation on all of us to sound intelligent is far too much, and therefore we need content to help us posture as intelligent, at least, even if we aren't. So I think that's really what we need to look at. Look in the mirror and you'll know what content to make.
Thanks. Pulak, what do you have to say about this, you know, whether content is going to change because of this ad revenue, the cap on the duration of ads, and how does it affect your business, you know?
Money is not necessarily a bad word. But having said that, too much of money, too much of monetizing proclivities has had this tendency of degenerating content, as we have seen in the recent past. Having said that, admittedly today the two revenue streams that are open to a broadcaster are advertising and subscriptions. And both on a rate basis happen to be the lowest in the world. Now if we have to give consumers a value proposition, it is important that we are also in a position to earn a decent amount of money for ourselves, so that we can keep a part of it for future growth and also reinvest a part of it for more fulfilling content. Now, per se, this 10+2 rule is most welcome. It's come at the right juncture, but having said that, what needs to be really appreciated is the approach that needs to be taken for implementing this rule, whether it should be ad hoc, whether it should be incremental approach, or whether it should be an absolutely immediate approach. So given a lot of, how do I put this, atmospherics that really governs the sector, the fact that your subscription revenues have been locked for more than a decade now, with only two occasional inflationary adjustments allowed, it's perhaps a time where we really need to reflect and see how we go about an incremental manner of enforcing this particular regulation. Having a drastic implementation of this particular regulation, to my mind, might, you know, impact broadcasters in a manner which would be not very congenial to their future progress. Having now, how do we then position this? It's a very challenging proposition. Viewers have been complaining that a movie that they could have otherwise seen in a 3 hour span is now taking at least 4 to 4.5 hours. Now, as broadcasters, do we turn a deaf ear to that? But at the same time, it also needs to be understood that for a channel like a sports channel, for example, where you have limited FCTs, you have varying rates, the cricket, if it's a cricketing event, it's a mass event, you get good amount of per second rate, and your quantum of available FCT is also quite high. But when it comes to a match like, for example, football, what is the available FCT that you have? What is, so you can't really apply a one-stop shop solution to this entire debate. So different channels will be having differing needs, but the issue that arises is when the regulator tries to apply a one-stop solution across the board that is supposed to be a permanent fit and a fixture for all channels. I'll give you some concrete examples. A sports content, right, is around 60x of that of a news content. Okay, the cost that I'm talking about. However, when it comes to this a la carte channel pricing, it's only about 3x, the difference here. So how do you basically address this gap? Even within genres, if we have to look at genres, there are multiple sports channels having varied content, but they all have to fit within a regulatory mandate which TRAI has laid down, saying that they have to be priced in the manner of a similarly placed channel. And we have to fight for a 50 paisa, 1 rupee differentia to trying to convince the regulator, you know, why we need this incremental price. Also, it needs to be understood that a sports right acquisition cost has gone up like 3x, 4x for properties like English cricket, or even for that matter, Barclays. But what has been the history of tariff increase? You have had once a 4% increase, and I think around 5 years back you had a 7% increase. After that, there has nothing that has happened to take the subscription revenues upward. Now, if you have to apply a 10+2 rule over and above this, it might create some amount of turbulence within the broadcasting sector. So all the way we look at it is perhaps if we implement it in an incremental fashion, perhaps with a time horizon, like a 3 to 6 month, it may not really be that painful an experience. But we see where it is coming from, we understand the relevance of it, and we know that for sure, if at all, it might have a congenial effect in bringing about a rationalization of the ad rates that we see today. So going forward, I don't really see this particular regulation really having a drastic adverse impact on content. If at all, it will liberate content from, you know, this continual tendencies that news, some broadcasters have of chasing eyeballs. It would liberate them from that and perhaps enable them to concentrate more on offering a proposition that is more amenable to the consumer, which would really enable him to pay more for the content that he receives.
Priyanka, I can see a lot of yawns and people on their mobile. I think we're boring them terribly. Do you want to open it up for questions?
Think,
maybe we should involve them.
Yeah, I think there's just something that
I'll just say
wants to
on
say.
This cap. I think in principle, as far as possible, government should just give the guidelines and not try to enforce any kind of time duration, etc. But at the end of the day, it is, I think consumers have to decide if there are so many channels and government can facilitate a level playing field where entry to the consumer house is not really a constraint, then if a channel is putting large amount of advertising, obviously people will not prefer that. But dictating that only this much should happen, it's a little bit impractical. I mean, how would you define home shopping 24-hour channel? There's nothing but 24-hour advertising. Tomorrow, what if someone comes out with a concept which shows, you know, one after another ad channel advertisements and people, and there's a niche which is keen to have that kind of a channel. So I think it's impractical that, okay, this kind of only duration should happen. There could be broad guidelines, but then it should be left to market dynamics.
So more like not a one sort of rule for everybody kind of thing. It should be according to different rules for different people?
Exactly. Would that not lead to see today you have, chaos? For example, HBO, before they came to the India, everywhere, I believe that globally, they never used to have advertising on their channels. Now, this is a market where they realized that that kind of subscription revenue they can't realize, and they created first time a channel which has subscription revenue plus advertising model. Now, recently they have launched, and Z also had launched a couple of years back, number of premium movie channels where they say there's no advertising, and if consumers want no advertising, they have to pay a little bit extra for that. Right. And that's how I think it's good for entire chain of events, because for all the stakeholders, because why will consumers pay more? They will pay more if they get the content, not only the same content, but something which whatever irritants are removed from there. So there are two models: that you want less subscription, then it is subsidized by advertising, so you will have to little bit go through that pain of seeing the advertising, and it will pave way for now with addressability, large number of channels, which will save USP is there is no advertising, whether it is news or it could be film or any other entertainment channel, and people who can afford that kind of price, they will go for those channels.
Okay, so that there can be a premium positioning with that sort of sure. thing, and as a differentiator between channels. Great. I think that was a good suggestion. Can we take some questions? Do you have, please?
Madam Moderator, I am Anup Bose. I am a senior advocate of the Supreme Court of India and an advisor to the House of Tatars. I've also been a broadcaster and telecaster in my younger days. Madam, before I ask any question or express any view, I crave your indulgence to raise our patriotic spirit just for 2 minutes. Madam, we are assembled here today under the dark, lamentable shadow of the most tragic death of Sarabjit Singh. And at this moment, I would feel fit in the fitness of things that we rise for 2 minutes and pay him homage and remember the song of Lata Mangeshkar, which she sang at a very way back in 1962. Ye वतन के लोगों ये मेरे वतन के लोगों जरा आंख में भर लो पानी. Why this song is important is because the dragon has entered our territory again. And this is the song that she sang when we were stabbed behind our back by China and Pandit Nehru broke down with the rest of the country. So before I ask any question or express my view, I would implore all of you, beseech all of you, and maybe madam you can lead them in silence to pay homage to a great soul of India. So I would suggest that we rise for 2 minutes and pay homage to one of our own countrymen who died on a soil that belonged to India once upon a time. Thank you. And now, two or three things. You know, I've been hearing the speeches since the morning, and in the first half we had very eminent people, Mr. Puri and Javed Akhtar would also express their views, and now there were certain points that I wanted to comment upon and seek the views of the panel today, the second half panel. One of the points that Mr. Puri raised was that he says that news channels do not make any money. Well, perhaps he was referring to the legal way of making money. But you will see increasingly there is a tendency, and some of my own clients have suffered, is that there's a tendency of media houses and news channels to make money by not following the legal path, by literally indulging in what in law we term as extortion. And whenever something happens, they take shelter behind the plea that we belong to the press and we enjoy the freedom of press. Article 19, 1A of the Constitution does not give unrestricted freedom to the press, madam. It is not only subject to the restrictions in Article 19.2. But we must remember that, say, in America and other countries where people indulge in obscenity, extortion, they are punished. So a member of the press and media can't say that I can even extort money and get away with it by saying that I belong to the press. No. And even immunity under the law, madam, is only given to a very specific, the President of India and the governors under Article 361 of the Constitution. But even their power is not something which is unlimited. The immunity is also limited to certain ends. So therefore, when we talk of making money, we must keep in mind media channels must restrain themselves from making money in what we call the hush money, you know. The second point that Mr. Puri raised when he talked of the legitimate extortion of the government. Here again, I feel the aspect of legitimate extortion must be matched with legitimate duties being performed by members of the media. Because sometimes we also take the government for a ride by trying to sort of, and I know of instances where even members of the media have sought seats in parliament or trying to twist the arm of the government. I shall leave it at that for the moment.
I'll just have to interrupt you a little bit here as to, is there any question that you have for the panel?
Yes, these are the issues on which I'd like...
I think there are other people who want to ask questions, so if you can just
so
ask the question.
So I've raised certain issues on which I would like the response of the panel. Yes.
Exactly. So, yes. You want to ask
here.
A question.
Hi. I'm Abhishek Jain. Good afternoon, everyone. My question is primarily to Mr. Marwa, that you rightly mentioned the content has been condensed. And I feel somewhere this is not because the content creators are getting more sharper or crisper in telling their story, but this is probably because of the imposition of the, or say, you can say in a very negative term, the exploitation of the distributors. Because if they could have been playing three shows, now they have got five shows to play in the theater. So are we making our content creators more, you know, are we training them towards precise or condensed content, or are we imposing something on them?
No. Just to answer your question, it's not just one factor. There are many factors, and the biggest factor is there is a social change. There is a change in the society. We are getting restless. We are getting impatient. We have too many things in our mind, we have too many commitments in a day, and maybe that's one of these are the major reasons that the duration of the programs we are reducing from longer to shorter duration. That's major reason.
But sometimes...
See, you have no patience left to see 3 hours film today, trust me.
I agree.
Even
I
if it's best film of the world, still you'll say, okay, yaar, aaj abhi aadhi dekhunga, aadhi kal dekhunga. And you've lost the game and you have lost the pleasure of actually watching the film. So that's one of the reasons. And it's a restless society where there's too many commitments, too many things in mind. It's a hush-hush which is going on today. And you still want to see a film because entertainment has become a very important part of life. I remember 20 years back, I was speaking on one of the very important dice, and I said that time that the time will come when the martial law of economics will change. I remember people laughed at me that who are you to change the martial law of economics? But I said, this is what I'm predicting. Martial law says roti, kapda aur makan. It all starts. The most in basic necessities, it is your first food. Second is your clothing. Third is shelter. But I'm very happy that there's a huge change which this industry has brought. Now it is food, second is clothing, third is entertainment, then is your shelter. And entertainment has become a very important part of life. Everybody wants to entertain themselves by different mode and means. And I have given you many causes of why the durations have been reduced.
Thank you.
Yes.
Brief and quick one. See, in the earlier session, I am Saxena. I am one of those distributors. I used to be the largest telecom company of India, and I was working there. The Javed Akhtar was saying that the creator is the god. You know, the people who are creating the content are the god or the content creator. So there are too many gods. The people who write the script, people who are broadcasting it and maybe the distributor and so on. But there is one person who is the consumer, banda. खुदा तो बहुत है, बंदा एक ही. आप बहुत शायरी कर रहे हैं तो मैंने कहा थोड़ा सा मैं भी बोल दूं. खुदा तो बहुत है, बंदा एक ही है. वो बेचारा बहुत सफर कर रहा है. आप जो चाहते हैं जितना भी कचरा है उसके आंखों में और उसके कान में डाल रहे हैं. एंड ही हैज नो कंट्रोल द न्यूज चैनल्स. यू नो इफ यू लुक एट इट द कंटेंट विच आर बीइंग प्रोवाइडेड. सो मच ऑफ डिविजन इन दिस कंट्री. नोबडी इज थिंकिंग अबाउट यूनिफाइंग द कंट्री. दे जस्ट शो ऑल दंगाज एंड ऑल फसाद बिकॉज ब्रेकिंग न्यूज हैज टू बी डन. So my question, which is a very straight question, is there a regulation which we'll bring in, self-regulation? I will not, I am the one who detests regulation. But are you thinking of bringing a self-regulation sometime other than just earning money all the time? Thank you.
Thank you. I think, Pulak, you'd be well pleased to answer that question, that does consumer have a right to, you know, sort of get the content that he actually wants and not the content that he's perceived to want?
One more quick comment. You know? If you want, I can answer the first one.
See, all these soap channels, soap operas, they only show conspiracies, you know, Sasu Bahu ka jhagda, all sorts of conspiracy, all sorts of negative things. Somewhere you should also feel, all of you, that you are also responsible to the society, which is giving you a hell of a lot of money.
Okay. I think the good thing was that, you know, Star Plus also introduced Satyamev Jayate, so they can feel a little happy about that. But Pulak, please answer that question.
Yeah, so I understand where your angst is exactly coming from, but we need to understand, insofar as the news channels are concerned, today you have 300 news channels, most of them are free to air, right? They don't have a revenue model built in. Where do they get their money from? So to the point of, you know, money being made otherwise, money being made beyond legalities, it has to be appreciated that today news channels don't really have a revenue building model. So how do you get around that? I'm sure your comments would be different if you see a CNN or a BBC. You'd never make that comment when you see, for example, a channel which has objectivity, highest journalistic standards and ethics inbuilt into their programming. Why is that not happening in India? It's because you have a regulation today in place which prohibits foreign experiences from coming into Indian shores. You don't have FDI being allowed in news channels. So where do these poor guys make their money from? Allow that to happen. Then you see how vistas will be opening up and consumers will be allowed immersive experience even in news.
But
coming to the second point.
Can I add something? If you allow me, I just want to answer you. Number one, Javed Saab, it was just an expression by Javed Saab that yes, content is God, because it is not a single